June 9th, 2019, hundreds of thousands marched the streets of Hong Kong, and as the days progressed, eventually this number grew to 2 million. Nearly a third of the population took to the streets dressed in black and white. For days, the protests continued. Even as they were hit with rubber bullets and tear gas, the people yelled, "Withdraw, withdraw." On June 12th, 11 people were arrested and 79 people were hospitalized due to injuries from bricks, tear gas, and pepper spray. Yet the violence continued, and despite the dangerous conditions, millions gathered around government buildings and streets and set blockades on roads, all to let their voices be heard. Why? Why are these people here? What was so important that millions of people were risking their lives and their well-being? All for what? To understand, we need to go back. In 1842, the First Opium War ended with China ceding control of Hong Kong Island to the Empire of Great Britain. And the colonies were expanded one more time in 1898 after obtaining a 99-year lease on the region known as the New Territories, making Hong Kong and the surrounding areas a British colony. However, this would only last until 1997, or 99 years, and then Britain would have to return Hong Kong to China. Hong Kong grew under British rule, expanding in economics, culture, and government. Hong Kong exploded and became the economic center of Asia. As Hong Kong grew, so did the differences between China. While Hong Kong had a Western-style government, China was mostly a communist state. As the years passed, 1997 drew closer, and the question in everyone's mind was, what's going to happen to Hong Kong? In September of 1982, UK Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher met with leader Deng Xiaoping, and eventually, the UK agreed to give Hong Kong back to China. In one condition, that the current social and economic systems in Hong Kong will remain unchanged, and so will the lifestyle. This became known as the One Country, Two Systems principle. However, this would only last another 50 years as a type of transition period, which would end in 2047. As it exists right now, Hong Kong is its own autonomous region. It has its own system of government, its own politicians, police, school systems, currency, and even different languages. Many Hong Kong supporters believe that China is slowly trying to erode the border between Hong Kong and China, gradually increasing their influence over the city region. February 2003, thousands of people in Hong Kong took to the streets to oppose what was known as the Hong Kong Basic Law, Article 23. It stated that the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region shall enact laws on its own to prohibit any act of treason, secession, sedition, subversion against the Central People's Government, basically giving the government power to do what it saw fit to prohibit treason, secession, or sedition. Many Hong Kong supporters interpreted this as an attempt by the Chinese government to limit the people of Hong Kong's freedom, namely their freedom of speech. However, eventually the bill was withdrawn. In September of 2018, a high-speed rail link opens between Hong Kong and mainland China. Passengers clear Chinese immigration inside the station in Hong Kong, prompting protests from some opposition lawmakers that Chinese law would apply in the immigration area. Later on that month, citing national security, Hong Kong bans the Hong Kong National Party, a party that advocates independence for Hong Kong. Many see this ban as a step to silence all separatist voices. October 2018, one of the biggest bridges in the world, a 55-kilometer or 35-mile long bridge from Hong Kong to Macau to the mainland, is finally open. Protesters view this as an effort to further link Hong Kong to mainland China, re-emphasizing the fact that Hong Kong is part of China. Which brings us to today. Millions of